Hello and welcome to the forum. I'm Michael Fontroy. Article 1, Section 8, Clause 17 of the U.S. Constitution reserves to Congress the power to exercise exclusive legislation in all cases whatsoever as it pertains to the District of Columbia. That power, coupled with a lack of statehood or full voting representation in Congress, has left the 600,000 residents of the District of Columbia with less democracy than their counterparts around the country. Toni Michelle Travis is here to examine the curious case of the District of Columbia. She is Associate Professor of Government and Politics at George Mason University and co-editor of the recently released book, Democratic Destiny in the District of Columbia, Federal Politics and Public Policy. Toni Michelle, welcome to the forum.
Thank you.
All right. Now, at the top, I mentioned this specific language in the Constitution as it relates to the District of Columbia. What do you see to be the result of that language, and how has it impacted the district?
Well, the district is not a state. It doesn't have statehood functions nor statehood representation, which would be voting members in the one at least in the U.S. House and two members of the Senate. So it's lacking that. It's in this hybrid position that it's seen as a city, acts as a city, but it also performs certain state functions, which it needs some federal help, usually funding.
Mm-hmm. Now, it's in this netherworld, as
yes.
you allude to. And it's reduced in terms of the rights and privileges of democracy for the residents.
Very definitely.
This is, of course, a democratic nation. So why should the citizens of the country care about what's going on as it relates to district governments and governance and democracy?
They should care, but they don't even know, which is part of the problem, that residents of our respective 50 states don't know unless they see a license plate that says taxation without representation, which is the district license plate. They don't know. They should care because these people are citizens. They didn't stop becoming citizens just because of residency in the District of Columbia. So they should have all rights and privileges, which they certainly do not have at this point. But they're citizens just like anyone else.
Well, you know, one of the things that strikes me about this, in almost all of the courses that I teach, mm-hmm. I ask the students to name the senators from the District of Columbia. And I tell them all, if you get this right, I'll give you an A right now. You don't have to come back for the rest of the semester. And then they start thinking and calling out names of people that have nothing to do with what's going on. And I'm struck by how many of them actually don't know the real status of the District of Columbia. And I'm wondering if we're talking about university students who don't know, what does that mean for the rest of the country?
Total lack of knowledge about it at all. Mm-hmm. I mean, they just think of it as a place with a lot of monuments and maybe a place for a school trip. I mean, people really don't know. I have students when I teach a course in Washington that one gentleman very candidly said he'd never seen Georgetown in daylight. You know, he didn't know people lived in neighborhoods in Washington. They don't have a sense that it is a city. There are not only current residents, but long-term residents, third, fourth generation.
Well, let me personalize this a little bit, because you grew up in Washington, D.C.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
When did you become aware that there was something different about your access to democracy, given where you lived, as opposed to somebody who lived in Maryland or Virginia, the rest of the country?
Very early on. I was in elementary school, and my father was adamant in the election of, I guess, 58, or whatever, 54 to 58 for Eisenhower, that we didn't have the right to vote in the district. He was a veteran of World War II and took out he registered in Massachusetts at Fort Devon. So he did have voting rights out of Massachusetts. But he also made the point of taking me to a polling place in Virginia on election day to see what a booth looked like and who the person was checking off names. And we took pictures. And then I took it back to the school, you know, show and tell type thing. It's very interesting to me. No one was in the polling place in midday, but that we didn't have it. We had no elected school board, no city council, no mayor. And what also disturbed him was to learn or to know that jurors were selected based on membership in civic associations. So if you didn't belong to a civic association, you were never going to serve as a juror in the District of Columbia in those days. And in the African-American community, it was very There were civic associations, but less attention paid to that than to other matters, I think.
And of course, that has great implications for jury selection. A jury of your peers may not necessarily be a jury of your peers if the only way you can get on a jury is if you're a member of a civic association.
That's true. I mean, okay. It's very, very clearly on that, yeah.
So around this same time, now, early 60s, you know, there had been agitation for greater representation, home rule, a variety of different sort of pathways to that, going back to the 19th and early 20th century. Yeah. So we get to the early 60s, and the first small step in that direction is a constitutional amendment that allows district residents to vote in presidential elections.
Yes.
So the first presidential election in which district voters could participate is 1964. Now, this is interesting to me because my grandfather at the time was 62 years old when he cast his first ballot for anything.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And there are all kinds of stories like that around the district, and I'm sure you're very well aware of those too. But also during this time, as we're again seeing agitation toward home rule, we see in the continuance of the district's governance through commission.
Yes.
And there are three commissioners who are appointed by the president to govern the district affairs. Take us through that a little bit.
Well, these people are not accountable to the residents of the District of Columbia. They're totally based on what the president thinks. Maybe they've contributed to the party, done something that the president knows about them. But also of the three, one is always a member of the Army Corps of Engineers. And I think to a great extent that person spurred civic engagement in that there was a proposal to put a highway right through the city, which would have cut up neighborhoods, I think, in more than one quadrant of the city. And the people became incensed over this idea and mobilized on it. And it was stopped. And I don't know if that's what caused the Beltway to be built in the way it was, but it kept the city from being sliced and diced with highways through it so people could go from New York to, say, Florida on the East Coast. People began to realize these commissioners did nothing for them, didn't care about their neighborhoods at all, and were totally unaccountable. And I think this was part of the moving force of saying we need to have our own representation.
So we have commissioners that aren't particularly effective or interested.
Yeah.
We have a burgeoning civil rights movement in the South that's percolating yes. toward the district. We have citizens inside the district calling for greater autonomy and change.
Yeah.
Lyndon Johnson is the president. As you move toward the middle of the 1960s, he sees and is supportive as to the extent mm-hmm. that he could be mm-hmm. for some change. And one of the things that he does is reorganize this commission system. Eliminating the three commissioner system and having just one commissioner that he referred to as the mayor commissioner. And his first appointment in that position is Walter Washington. Talk a little bit about the reorganization and Walter Washington and what he brought to the district.
Well, I think Lyndon Baines Johnson knew the district, and he knew the district's problems, and he knew Congress very well. And he didn't feel that he could appoint a mayor outright because of Southern Democrats controlling Congress and its committees, especially the one on the House District Committee. So he devises this plan that, so to speak, eases someone into a mayoral position by the hyphenated title commissioner-mayor. And Walter Washington, I think, was a wonderful selection because Walter Washington had gone to Capitol Hill many times, knew many of those Southern congressmen, in that he worked with National Capital Housing Authority, and he reported to Congress on that. He also knew the problems in the neighborhoods in the district. He lived in the Leroy Park area. And so he had a number of qualities that were very appealing to the president, even though maybe the electorate didn't know him very well. But he was also trained in public administration and law, two very key components of his future duties.
Mm-hmm. And he was also not perceived to be sort of a quote-unquote militant black leader, which was some of the concern that people had during that time. So in that regard, he was a safe choice.
Oh, very definitely. He was older. He wasn't militant. He developing gray hair, and mm-hmm. he was acceptable to a broad base of the community.
Okay, so he's appointed as mayor commissioner, and as the years go on, the city moves toward closer home rule. In 1968, the city is granted the right to elect a school board. So, again, an additional step along the way. Take us through Walter Washington's sort of career and his legacy as he transitions from being mayor commissioner in through home rule governance.
Well, I think part of the legacy is a smooth transition from a three-person governing body to a one-person, which has to be set up with a city council. He did that with a lot of problems. I mean, also, he noted in an interview, when he came in, there was a debt. The city was not fiscally responsible. I mean, the budget was out of whack. But nobody knew that because Congress was controlling, so that wasn't very public knowledge at the time. So he sets up a whole new budget process. He works with the city council. He works with the business leaders. And he begins to get people, I think, noticing two things. One, that there is somebody who's acting as a mayor. And two, maybe citizens should be more responsive to participating now that we have a new structure. So he comes in, faced with a number of problems. This is a Vietnam era with demonstrations almost daily that his local police have to deal with. And the civil rights movement moving along. So he's got that plus governing to handle. And given his resources, he did very well.
You mentioned some of the crises, and I want to add one more, and that is the riots following the assassination of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. You know, how much of his time, that is Washington's time, was sort of spent dealing with these crises that popped up in the streets?
Yeah.
Civil rights riots, you know, the tearing up of the city in some places.
I think the riots was the big defining moment for him because he realized that race relations was a key component of his job, given the Capitol Hill's in the picture, the president's in the picture, and local residents. And he made the decision that he would not give the order, contrary to other mayors, of shoot to kill. And therefore, the police did not kill anyone during the riots. With huge amount of property damage, large number of people, young people primarily, put in jail or arrested. But no one was killed, and he did not want to, so to speak, start a race war of blacks against whites. He also, I'm pretty sure, very early on, recognized that he was going to have to appeal to the business community to come back into D.C. because of so much property damage to set a new tone that we are going to work together to rebuild the city.
So he's in a position where he uses this as a foundation toward a new city.
Yes.
Part of that newness is the Home Rule Act of 1973, which gets passed. He is then elected to a new term in 1974 as the mayor, not mayor commissioner. There's a city council in place. There's also a congressional delegate who was elected in 1971. And as we move toward the 1978 election, we see a Mayor Washington who had been on the scene for, you know, a decade or so as the chief executive of the city. And he's running in the 1978 Democratic primary against City Council Chairman Sterling Tucker and City Council member Marion Barry.
Right.
What happens?
Well, I think that Walter Washington was much more public administrator than politician. I think those who were advising him didn't know how to run a three-way race. You don't run a three-way race the same as you do with just one opponent. And Sterling Tucker may be perceived as a spoiler, but he certainly drew votes away from Walter Washington or maybe even Marion Barry, but Barry comes out then the winner, and I think Washington was a bit stunned. Also, the Washington Post said, oh, we need a fresh face, new ideas, and they put out an endorsement for Marion Barry.
Which is stunning, given what we know about Barry as we move into 2011. Many people would not know that not only did the Washington Post endorse Marion Barry in that race, but his coalition, his winning coalition, was the most multiracial coalition of any of the candidates who were in the race.
Well, he looked one way at the time of that race. Mm-hmm. And I think Walter Washington began to look outdated. His style, his manner, it was too slow. It was plodding. It was very public administration, not, you know, well, we're going to get it done because I have young people who can just move right ahead on it. Mm-hmm. And the Post rejected that. The voters obviously rejected that. In the long run, Barry is another issue in terms of problems.
Yeah, and that's a whole different program, and I don't want to devote a lot of attention to that now because we'll be sidetracked. Yeah. But one of the things that I'm interested in the book, Democratic Destiny, is your take on Sharon Pratt Kelly, who was elected in 1990 and is the first African-American woman elected to run a major American city. This is 1990, okay? What are your recollections of Sharon Pratt Kelly?
Well, I think Sharon Pratt Kelly just inherited the biggest of problems following Marion Barry, and I think she was not good at management. She was good at the politics on the Hill. She got additional money for the district when they needed it back then. She had not held elected positions before, and so she had a couple of problems. One was the day-to-day management of government. She wasn't trained in public administration. And she had to build or create good relations with the city council, which were lacking. And I don't think she had the skills from years of experience. She never served on the city council, so she didn't have that background. And I think the city council, to some extent, closed ranks and considered her an outsider.
Add to that the fact that it was the true depths of the district's fiscal picture weren't really revealed until after she gets in the office, and things are far worse than she anticipates.
Very definitely the case. But then with that, she's saying she's going to lay off people, she's going to clean house, and then she finds out what the civil service rules are for the District of Columbia, and that is not an easy task.
Mm-hmm. So we're in the 1990s. They're still pushing, there are people still advocating for greater voting representation. We had the 1978 attempt to amend the Constitution that expired in 1985, unsuccessfully so. And we get back to 1994, and a blast from the past returns to win the mayoralship. That's Marion Barry. And then after Marion Barry, and beginning in 1988, so now, for quite frankly, we have a series of sort of technocratic people running the city, right? What do you see there?
Well, I think the problem of the District of Columbia, some see, is because of race. I think part of it is because of management. If we could separate out some of the issues and we could get a federal payment or the amount of money that Congress should be allocating to the district, that would be one issue. Then let's see if we can manage it properly. I think Tony Williams and Fenty have shown that with good management, Congress looks upon the district differently. But we're now facing not the Southern Democrats, but the Republicans in terms of, well, why should we give more money to the district? So the problem goes on with reiterations.
And in 1997, under the Clinton administration, we have a reorganization program, reorganization plan that makes some changes. We have a control board as put in place by Congress that also makes some changes in terms of the fiscal structure of the district. But essentially, the political structure is unchanged since the Home Rule Act of 1973. Why do you think Congress has been so unwilling to make any real change in that regard?
I think they don't care, and I don't think they get any points at home for doing anything for the District of Columbia. It's of no moment to them, and unless they can get political mileage out of something, and I don't think they see the district as providing that in any way for them.
But there are members of Congress who argue that democracy is important in Iraq and Afghanistan and Cuba and North Korea, and every other country in the world, and we've helped recreate a constitution in Iraq and in other places that does not sort of overlook the residents of the capital cities in those places. So, and this is, I guess this is an obvious question, but how can we do that there and not do that here.
They're hypocritical. I mean, on the face of it. I mean, it's not following our policy abroad by any means. That needs to be pointed out to the residents in the various states mm-hmm. who elect these people to Congress. I think the first step is to find out who's going to head the House District Committee and, you know, what are their views and try to get to them. I mean, the incoming Mayor Vincent Gray may be quite correct. We have to take the case to Capitol Hill, not just have him go up or his appointed people go up, but demonstrate again.
I was going to go there but uh-huh. later, but I want to okay. do it now. It's my position that the residents of the District of Columbia become so sort of acclimatized to their political status that they've sort of accepted it and become kind of obedient to it. What will it take to get people back into the streets to make the point to Congress as you just described?
Well, some of the most vocal people are people who've moved to the district because they can compare what they had versus what the district is like. The local residents don't have any comparison unless they go and live in a state. And that's why I think they're sort of politicized not to demonstrate and see that they have to push for more rights, for their rights. I think it's going to take a couple of outsiders or people who've come in to get the district people motivated and the district's mayor, Vincent Gray. I mean, I think he possibly can do this.
Mm-hmm. You, as I mentioned earlier, the co-editor of Democratic Destiny mm-hmm. And the District of Columbia. How did that project come together?
That was a Ron Walters project with many of the authors in this edited volume who were former students who wanted to write on the District of Columbia. And when Ron called me to write about Walter Washington, I said, oh, I'd like to be co-editor, and that's how I came into the picture. Mm-hmm. But the majority of people are people he was the mentor to, the professor for.
And what do you think can happen with the book in terms of educating the public on this issue?
I think we've got a good opportunity to educate the public. The statehood party's very interested in making sure this book is in the hands of every councilman and the incoming mayor, of making sure this word gets out, that the district still doesn't have voting rights in Congress. There are people who want statehood. We still don't have a budget worthy of all the services that Congress causes us to pay for, certainly with demonstrations with the World Bank or anything like that, and that the word get out to the states, to the elected officials, that we are the exception to the rule of the U.S. promoting democracy everywhere else, except at home.
Now, there has been an attempt to expand within the rules of the House of Representatives the capacity for the district's representative in Congress, the delegate, mm-hmm. to vote on the floor of the House, which the delegate cannot do constitutionally. Are you sort of optimistic or pessimistic of that plan? And what do you think going forward as it relates to district representation in Congress?
Well, I'm pessimistic at this point because if the Republicans are in control, I don't think whoever heads the committee is going to find it a priority, even though we've had, so to speak, good governance under Fenty. In fact, very good governance. The district gets blamed for its own financial problems, and it doesn't have a proper tax base to even adequately fund most of the things in the district. So I'm not optimistic on it, even though I think that's probably the push that should be made.
So we have this circumstance in which after the decennial census, the seats in the House of Representatives are reapportioned. And after the 2000 census, the state of Utah felt like it did not get the proper count, right, which would have resulted in the state of Utah getting an additional seat in the House mm-hmm. of Representatives, and that seat instead went to North Carolina. And since then, there has been talk of a potential deal that would temporarily expand the size of the House of Representatives so that Utah can get a seat, and that would make Republicans happy. Excuse me, and the District of Columbia would get a vote, which would make Democrats happy. Where are we on that? And we've already passed the 2010 census, and the House is about to be restructured again.
I think Utah wins on that, and we lose. I don't think that kind of proposal is going to come up again. That was Congressman Tom Davis. It was a peculiar deal, but it was a deal that was struck, and they still couldn't get it passed. So I don't know where we stand on somebody bringing forth another proposal to say, okay, the district ought to come in to satisfy the partisan issues on Republican, Democratic.
Well, we have had a number of presidents weigh in on D.C. voting rights, statehood, however you want to characterize it. And generally it breaks down on partisan lines. The Republicans are in opposition, the Democrats are in support. And in two periods during the course of the last two decades, we've had unified government under Democrats, under both President Clinton and President Obama, and there's been no movement whatsoever on this. What do you think that's about?
I think it's not a priority. It doesn't win them points. And I think those who are in Congress, as well as the president, I mean, the president's got two wars, or he would say one going now, but all these international issues facing the president, the fiscal state of our states is not good. I think our congressional representatives are concerned about that. The district is a throwaway issue for them.
Thank you very much for joining us, and thank you all very much for watching. Please tell your friends about the forum. Until next time.